I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word.
I will make the matter of my feet and the light of my path, and will hide his word in my heart, and I might not sin against God.
Amen. You may be seated. Do you have your Bible with you today? Amen. Praise God. Just beginning to look at a lot of passages today. One of the most popular holidays on the Christmas calendar is Christmas. Christmas honors the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and it is observed by most Christian churches all over the world. The name Christmas did not appear until the 11th century, and that was, to be exact, 1038. The word comes from the Old English, and I have no idea how to pronounce it. I've been looking for this and how to pronounce it. It's Christus Mais, which means the Mass of Christ. And if you search the internet, there will be some just for this word. Okay, somebody says, "Oh, it's the." A birth of Christ. It is the Mass of Christ, or it is the death of Christ. Which one is it? So be careful out there when you're doing your search, okay? The earliest records mention a feast held in the church at Alexandria in Egypt around AD 200 to honor the Nativity. You know what Nativity means, right? It refers to your birth. The celebration of Christmas did not become a church-wide celebration until the late 3rd and early 4th centuries. And a variety of dates have been associated with the Feast of the Nativity. Western churches observe the feast on the 25th of December, while most churches in the East observed it on January 6th, and that's what we call Epiphany, or the Catholic would call it the Three Kings, okay? It is a Christian festival commemorating the coming of the Magi to the birth of Jesus Christ. The one exception seemed to be the church at Constantinople, where the designated day mirrored that of the Western Church. By the end of the 4th century, almost all Christian churches had accepted the December day. So that's the reason why we are celebrating Christmas on December instead of January. Well, we will find out later which one is really the right one. But according to our tradition, we're doing this in December 25. Amen? Though the church at Rome maintained that day, December 25th, was the actual birth of our Lord Jesus Christ, the most likely day, according to civil and historical records, was sometime around the Jewish festival called the Feast of Tabernacles, which was celebrated in the fall. Now, if you look at what happened to the shepherds, when they saw the angels, when they heard the good news from the angels, where they at? They were out there in the field at night. You cannot do that on the winter time. Right? So that's the, think about that. Now, the unanimous adoption of the December date came about as an attempt by the church to integrate Christian ideals into the winter solstice festivals celebrated during that season. Now, let's look at these slides right here. You see these things? These are the ancient Christmas customs that survive to this day. Decorations of evergreen, wreaths, holly, mistletoe, along with Christmas trees, found in many homes during the season. Colored lights and candles are often displayed. Christmas gift giving is an intimate time for many families. Children's eyes light up at the mention of Santa Claus. And in some parts of the country, the 12 days of Christmas are a time of great banquets, caroling throughout neighborhoods, exchanging presents, and attending parties. We are now into one of the best times of the year, and that is the Christmas season. You see this? Have you noticed? Amen. How many of you have already started your Christmas shopping? Maybe you already started during the Black Friday, right? But how many are already finished shopping for Christmas? How many are not going to shop?
No.
Well, it is a busy time of the year, amen? And when we keep our focus on the real significance of Christmas, it can be the best time of the year. I will preach again about Christmas on the 25th, which I hope will help keep our attention on the true meaning of celebrating Christmas. Amen? Now look at this next slide. Oh, we see Santa Claus, sleigh bells, reindeer, snow falling, icicles forming, Christmas music playing all around us. Christmas lights during the night. Oh my goodness. You see those houses? I haven't put up my lights yet, so when you pass by my house, there's nothing in there. All my neighbors, they have their own lights. It's like I'm the only one that's in the light. Maybe the people here are thinking that, what religion is this guy? You know what I mean? But is this what Christmas is all about? Somewhere in the midst of the hustle and bustle of all the festivities, the real meaning of Christmas is lost. Let me tell you a story here. A little boy came home from Sunday school. He was so excited learning about the wise men who brought gifts to the baby Jesus. He was so excited that he has to tell his whole family during lunchtime. And he said, "Today, I have learned in Sunday school all about the first Christmas." And he said, "There was not a Santa Claus way back then, so these three fellows on camels had to deliver all the toys. And Rudolph, the red-nosed reindeer with his nose so bright, was not there either. So they had to have this big spotlight in the sky to find their way around." What kind of version do you have of the Christmas story? Christmas is supposed to be the time of year where we celebrate the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But unfortunately, it has become a commercial holiday rather than a religious one. And it is mostly known as a time for businesses to make money, for people to give gifts, for children to be excited, for parties, etc., etc., etc. The reason for the season is supposed to be Jesus. Not gifts, not parties, not Santa Claus. The celebration of Christmas is supposed to be a recognition and appreciation of the coming of the Son of God into the world. The question is, why does the Son of God have to come into the world? One of the ways to go about answering that question this morning is to listen patiently to the different testimonies from the Bible about why the Son of God came into the world. You see, I believe that the Bible is inspired by God. That's what Paul says. All scripture is inspired by God and is therefore very powerful to vindicate its own truthfulness. So I want to let six of these witnesses speak and testify to why the Son of God had to come into the world. The witnesses are Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Paul, and the author of the Hebrews. The answers they give are reasons for Jesus coming. So, let's look at Mark's testimony. Mark chapter 10, verse 45. The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. The word ransom came from the Greek word lutron, which means the purchasing money for manumitting slaves. Have you heard that word before? Manumit. It's another word for to free. Okay? So to free. Especially the sacrifice by which expiation is effected. Have you heard that word before? Expiation? Yes? Okay, then I don't need to tell you that. Expiation is an act of making an atonement, an offering of expiation. You know, this reminds me of the movie Ransom. Anybody saw that movie? Mel Gibson and Rene Russo. The movie focuses on Mel Gibson's character, which is, he was what, Tom Mullen, a rich airline owner, and he was shocked when his son was kidnapped. And he was willing to pay the $2 million ransom. But what happened is that the drop goes wrong. So now, Tom turns the ransom money into a bounty on the head of the kidnapper. The movie has a line in it that probably gave them the title. Someone is going to pay. And that exactly what the word ransom means. The word means that someone is going to pay. A ransom is the price paid for to free someone from captivity or punishment. When we think of ransom in a religious sense, especially in Christianity, we think of ransom as a deliverance from sin or its penalty. The reason we need a ransom to be paid for us is that we have sold ourselves into sin and have been alienated from a holy God. When Jesus gave his life as a ransom, our slave masters, which is sin, death, and the devil, had to give up their claim on us. And the result was that we could be adopted into the family of God. Now let's look at Paul's testimony. Paul put it like this in his letter to the Galatians, chapter 4, verses 4 through 5. When the time had fully come, God sent forth his Son, born of woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoptions as sons. In other words, the redemption or the ransom frees us to be a part of God's family. We had run away and sold ourselves into slavery to sin. But God pays a ransom and redeems us out of that slavery into the Father's house. Hallelujah. Now let's look at the testimony here of the author of the book of Hebrews. You know, until now, scholars cannot really pinpoint who wrote the book of Hebrews. Until now. Let's look at this. Chapter 2, verse 14. Since the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same nature, that through death he might destroy him who was the power of death. In other words, the reason Christ took on human flesh so that he could die and in dying pay a ransom and free us from the power of death. God's Son had to become a human being so that he could suffer and die in our place to pay the ransom. And that is the meaning of Christmas. Let's look at the testimony of Luke. Luke chapter 5, verses 31 and 32. Jesus said to them, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." Luke testifies that Jesus came to call sinners to repentance. First, there needed to be a ransom to be paid for sinners. Then there could be a successful call for sinners. The call is based on the ransom. And Jesus says, he came for both of these things. He does not leave the ransoming or calling to others. He ransoms and he calls. Even today, he is calling through the Bible and through the preaching of the Bible. And he is calling at this very moment. Let me tell you a story of Pastor Vance Havner. Pastor Vance Havner tells the story of a lady who came forward during the invitation in one of his worship services to be saved. She was a very sophisticated and refined woman. She had a graduate degree and was very articulate and intelligent. So when she came forward during the invitation, Pastor Havner asked her, "Why have you come forward?" Havner doesn't know why he said it this way, but he asked, "Ma'am, do you realize that you are a hell-bound sinner, worthy only of God's judgment?" That sounds cruel, right? So she looked at him in shock, disbelief, and said, "Why no? I've been good all my life." So he said, "Well, in that case, ma'am, you cannot go to heaven. Why don't you have a seat over there? Because you cannot be saved." So bewildered, she went to one of the front row seats. On the next verse of the song of invitation, she came forward again and said, "Sir, I would like to be saved." Once again, Pastor Havner said, "Ma'am, to be saved, you have to have something to be saved from. To be saved is to be saved from sin. Until you recognize that you are lost, helpless sinner, you cannot be saved. Jesus said, those who are well have no need of physician, but those who are sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." Suddenly, it was as if he saw a light go off in her head. So he asked, "Ma'am, do you realize that you are a poor, lost, wicked sinner in need of God's grace?" Tears rolled down her cheeks as the shame for her sin overcame her soul. "Yes, I do," she said. When she said that, she was in a place where God could save her. And Hebner was able to lead her to Christ. No one, not even one, will be able to go to heaven on their own. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. The Son of God have to come to call sinners to repentance. And that is the meaning of Christmas. He came to call sinners. Now, let's look at Matthew here. Matthew testifies in his gospel, chapter 10, verses 34 to 37. Do not think that I have come to bring peace on earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a man's foes will be those of his own household. Anyone who loves their father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves their son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. The point of this word is not that God loves division and strife. The point is that strife and division caused by true allegiance to Jesus are better than no strife and division with no allegiance to Jesus. The point is that when a person is ransomed and called, something really radical happens to them. The dividing line between those who accept Jesus and those who reject him would even run through families. The sword that Jesus spoke of would sometimes cut through families. In strong terms, Jesus explained that the disciple must love and follow Jesus supremely. Our devotion to Jesus must come above even our own household. You know, one time I heard a pastor says that his priority is his wife. So I have to rebuke him. And I said, Pastor, you cannot be a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ, because Jesus has to be the first place. Jesus has to be the priority in your life, not your wife. I'm sorry to tell you that. Is your family your priority? You know what Jesus said? You are not worthy of me. For this Jesus came into the world. And that too is the meaning of Christmas. And last, the last witness here. John. And John has three things to testify about the coming of the Son of God. First, the Son of God came to give sight to the morally blind. John chapter 9, verse 39, Jesus said, "For judgment I came into this world, that those who do not see may see." And John 12, 46, Jesus said, "I have come as light into the world, that whoever believes in me might not remain in darkness." Jesus did not merely come to ransom and to call. He also came to open people's eyes so that they can see the light and walk in it. Our problem is not just slavery to sin, needing a ransom, or lostness, needing a call. Our problem is also moral blindness. needing the gift of sight. We are simply blind to some spiritual realities that are utterly crucial to see and embrace. This is why Christ came, that those who do not see may see. That is the meaning of Christmas. The second thing that it testifies about the coming of the Son of God is that the Son of God came to save us from divine condemnation. John chapter 3, verses 17 and 18. For God sent not the Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already. God sent his Son to save us from his own just condemnation and wrath. The need for salvation implies that there is a danger we need to be saved from. That danger is sin, death, and the devil. But let me tell you, the most serious danger of all is the danger of the condemnation of God. If God is for us, then sin and death and the devil will fail to destroy us. But if God is against us, nothing can save us. Paul, in his letter to the Romans, also testifies about this. You know, it is not safe to call any one chapter of the Bible the greatest chapter, because the entire Bible is great. It is God's Word. Nevertheless, there is a sense in which the eighth chapter of the book of Romans is even superlatively great. These 39 verses begin with no condemnation and end with no separation, while in between there is no defeat. One must imagine that the Bible is a ring, and the book of Romans, its precious stone. Chapter 8 would be the sparkling point of the jewel. Did you get it? In the book of Romans, chapter 8, it starts with, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And it ends with what? Nothing can separate us from the love of God. And in between, there is no defeat. You know why? Because God, through Christ, made us more than conquerors. Is there any defeat for a conqueror? But God made you more than that. More than a conqueror. So don't think that you're a loser. Amen? Because you are more than conqueror. Christmas, the coming of Jesus, it's God's way of being for us if we will believe. He who believes is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already. And the third thing that John testifies to the coming of the Son of God, he said that the Son of God came to give us eternal life. Now, look at this. This is the heart of the scriptures. John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. If you are a Christian, eternal life does not simply mean going to heaven for eternity. Eternal life means a never-dying spirit that has already sprung to life in you. In other words, eternal life starts now. Your life that lasts eternally in the next world is the same life that begins here in this world. When you die, only your body dies. Your spirit, your eternal spirit that is the essence, the deepest reality of who you are, never stops existing. Never. You pass from one life into another one with not a moment's gap in existence. You know, it does a great harm to Christian ideals when heaven is simply some abstract place after death where we sit on clouds playing harp. You know, if I really thought that was heaven, I think I would sign up for the other place. You know what I mean? Forget harps, okay? For me, surely heaven is the place where the electric guitars are. My friends, eternal life begins here on this earth. When God's Spirit breathes into our spirits the breath of life, and our spirits spring to life for the first time, suddenly capable of living without sin. At that moment, they take on a completely different quality and kind of life. Let me tell you, plants are alive. Look at this. You know that they're alive, right? But not in the way dogs are. Dogs are alive, but not in the way humans are. Human beings without Christ are alive, but not in the way human beings with Christ are. There are different levels of life. And when Christ comes into our lives, He gives us the best kind of life. One that starts at that moment and never ends. It could be said that Christ's follower is in heaven already, because they have already begun eternal life with Christ. So the moment you've been born again, you receive eternal life already. Eternal life starts right there. And it could be said that the person without Christ is in hell already, because hell is simply the absence of God. Life with Christ is heaven. Life without Christ is hell. And those things are true no matter which side of the world you're on. Christians will inherit everything Christ has been given by God, including spirits that are alive to God and will spend all eternity with Him, starting right here in this world. Christmas means that God sent His Son so that we could believe and have eternal life. I want to close by urging you to believe in Jesus and to receive this gift of eternal life, and to set out in a life that magnifies God and His rich grace as the giver of every good and perfect gift. Let's all stand together. We are going to read our prayer. This is a responsive prayer for the Christmas season. I'm going to read the the lines that are not bold in print, you will be reading the bolder print. Amen? And let this be our prayer for this Christmas season. Because you were willing to humble yourself, to become human, to make yourself nothing. Because you were born poor, weak, and homeless. Let's go back to the very beginning. Is that the beginning?
Yeah.
Okay. What's the next one? Okay. Because God, out of His great love for us, sent you to live among us and die for us.
May you believe that you are the Messiah, and therefore not perish, but have eternal life.
Because those infant hands of the babe in the manger were pierced on the cross as you bore our sins. Because you, the infant in swaddling clothes, are our great high priest, who was tempted in every way just as we are, yet was without sin. Because God has raised us with you on account of your sacrifice, sitting us with you in the heavenly, above all powers and authorities. Because you are the promised Messiah, the Creator of life, the King of kings and Lord of lords, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. May we adore you, praise you, and bless you today throughout the coming year. Because you, the root and offspring of David, the bright morning star, have promised to come again soon.
May we all live in your expectation of your return. Amen.
Ah, Lord Jesus, you may be seated. What happened to our lives? Amen. Okay. Did you learn something today about celebrating Christmas? That's the very reason why the Son of God has to come. Amen?